So it's, I guess, one of the most famous books that no one's read. Fun buying books in German. Every once in a while, we were on the West Berlin side, but we could get, since we were allies, we could get East passes, so we could just basically decide, okay, well, go on a trip. You could even just drive. I could drive over. So I could just drive my car over and show my East Pass and like go over. So we went to things like the opera. The opera over there was really cheap. It was basically $5 to go to the opera. And they had, of course, really, you know, like just like the Bolshoi, really great productions of whatever they did. And then, but we would go to the bookstore, and it was German, Polish, Russian books. So nothing in English, but we were all linguists, so we'd have like a whole busload of us basically shopping around. And we'd pick out all these Russian books, and we're all at the counter with the Russian books, and the cashier would speak to us in Russian. We were obligated to not let them know we spoke Russian. So we acted like we didn't understand her until she said how much the books were in German. And then, oh, so then we understood that, you know, we could buy the books. You know. It was just so dumb, you know. I remember one time I found a really beautiful book about Poland with all sorts of beautiful color photos. I was going to buy that. And the lady refused to sell it to me because she says, no, and she gave me a German book that had all black and white pictures. Because she figured I couldn't read the Polish, right? Sorry, you know, I would have been fine with the Polish. It's basically Russian except the different alphabet, right? So, but it was my alphabet. I mean, if I saw something like this in Polish, typically get kind of confuzzled in English, but if you know, well, that's just that, then you're fine. Sh is a Russian letter. So when you see that, it's sh, right? No. Right? So, you know what I mean? You study Russian, you can have no problem with reading Polish, because what usually throws us off is all the letters, you know. How do you take that many letters and pronounce it? What do you do with it? But it makes sense, because there's sh, ch, sh, ch, you know, are three separate letters in Russian. Russian has 33 letters. We have, what, 23 in our alphabet? German is similar, of course, but they notice they don't have a double U, they have a double V. Actually occurs to me that, well, our W is actually a double V too. But the result is, you know, when you see Wagner, it's pronounced Wagner. Right? Wagen, your car, you know, is your Wagen, right? Your wagon. Right? Richtig? Yes? You speak German, right? Ambition. You should learn whatever they speak. Take advantage of it. Because the more languages you learn, the more confused you will be. Something like that. It's a good thing.
Is your bookmarker an indication of how far you got through the first time, or have you?
I don't.
Have you?
It's so long. I don't know why these bookmarkers. I have bookmarkers, all sorts of different. I don't know. I looked at it just briefly. Should I leave that bookmarker in?
You just curious.
And I'm thinking, you know, this is mental health, you know, what? I don't even remember. I bet if you called her, she's probably no longer there. I don't know what that was.
Or what the writing style was like. I mean, when you what was your...
Oh.
You're thinking of it.
It's not a very good book, but it's very informative with regard to his mindset. And you can see, you know, this is actually a lot like Trump. You know, if you've looked at, Trump has 15 books out there. You know, how to make a deal, you know, and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And you know, it's aimed at a very low caliber audience. So now that's kind of intriguing. You know, when you write a book, don't write the book that you just. Now, I written a book? Well, one, but that was my thesis, right? So, when you're supposedly writing a book, if you want it to sell, don't write the book that you want to write. Write the book that your audience wants to read, because otherwise they won't buy it, basically. So, and that's something that kind of shows. But the reason I brought Hitler into this is because there's a clear connection between Nietzsche and Hitler. We're really getting close to the end, aren't we? So Nietzsche and the Superman, that's just another translation of Übermensch, right? When you hear the expression Übermensch, you've heard of that, right?
Mm-hmm.
No, you haven't used that.
No.
I've heard people though use the word Uber.
Uber.
Right? Which just means it's German for over. Uber.
It's a car service. Uber is a car service, I believe.
Yeah, which literally just means over. Like they're, well, so an Übermensch is an overman, literally, but you could translate it Superman, because it's supposed to be the next evolutionary step. So it's not just a mere muggle, you know, it's an Übermensch, right? but I think a better translation is a Superman. But we have that icon of American comic book, you know, Superman. And it seems to me that because a lot of Nietzsche's works were being translated and introduced to the American public at about the same time that Superman was a big, you know, comic character, right? He even had TV shows with terrible black and white special effects, you know, where he's flying, you know. By the way, the guy that played that in the TV show actually committed suicide by jumping off of a building thinking he could fly.
That's not good.
From what I understand. The guy that played that Superman in the TV show. I think at the same time, the translation of Superman, if they had translated it as Superman, they figured that wouldn't go over well, so they changed it to Overman in English. But today, we just mostly stick to Übermensch. In fact, in my quiz question, I referred to it as a Nietzschean. So the quiz question I posted for class today is, are there any Nietzscheans that you find likable people? So what is a Nietzschean? And, you know, do they actually readily identify as a Nietzschean? One for sure that I know of that in interviews years ago referred to herself as a Nietzschean was Madonna, the singer. Madonna said she was a Nietzschean. So that's kind of intriguing. Hitler would probably think of himself as such, an Übermensch, a Nietzsche. Are they the same? That's a good question. I suppose, strictly speaking, if you're a Nietzsche and you believe Nietzsche's philosophy and you want to follow that, but basically if you are, you would be considered an Übermensch, or at least consider yourself an Übermensch. And by the way, by the time class is over today, if you aren't already, you should be Übermenschen yourself. Überfrauen? Which would be preferred? I don't know. Not Überfrauen, obviously, for everyone, but you get the idea. Now, what's the deal, right? So, Nietzsche, born 1844, dies in 1900. Fairly young. He was actually ill most of his life. Good question, what did he actually have? A lot of people think he had syphilis. His father actually died fairly young when he was young, and the symptoms were the same. So at the time they called it softening of the brain. The brain just basically deteriorates. Which could be syphilis, but no one really knows for sure, because I guess they haven't dug up his body to find out. It's kind of interesting, they dug up Beethoven and checked his hair and discovered that he had lead poisoning.
Hmm.
And obviously you can get that by drinking wine in pewter cups, so don't do that. Because the alcohol leaches the lead out of the pewter, and that actually explains an awful lot of his symptoms, including the hearing loss, the anger, all sorts of things. So he's born in Prussia, which isn't there anymore. I mean, the place is still obviously there, the town is still there, but we don't call it as a country Prussia anymore. Most of it is now northern Poland, so it's not really a German-speaking country. His father was a Lutheran minister, but notice he died when Nietzsche was five. And as a result, he was raised by his mother, grandmother, two aunts, with his sister, right? So five women in the house and him, right? His sister was younger, and would live longer, by the way. Or at least she lived longer. I'm not sure if she was younger or not, but I think so. But for example, we have pictures of Frau Nietzsche, which as far as I know, she never married. So, G-S-C-H-E, Hitler, let's look at images, so there he is with the bust of Nietzsche, okay, so this is Nietzsche's sister. Kind of created a home, kind of a memorial museum to her brother. She also helped publish some of his later works, which hadn't been published during his lifetime. And as an editor, she edited them to kind of make sure that they appeared to support the Nazi philosophy. There was a Nazi philosophy. It's not like the Nazis were so cacophonic that there was no actual philosophical approach at all. But arguably, it wasn't really what Nietzsche would have argued for. So that's kind of intriguing. So a lot of attempts to and psychoanalyze him, basically conclude that he was just dominated by so many women that he had no real male role model that might have influenced the way he grew up, who knows. Study classical philology at Bonn and Leipzig, so that's the study of basically ancient languages, so like mostly Greek. Greek ancient Greek literature, things like that. So. And he was so brilliant that he was appointed professor of classical philology at the University of Basel at the age of 24, which is incredibly young, and also very strange because he hadn't even published his thesis yet. And that was unheard of, basically. But so it must have meant that his faculty thought the world of him and basically thought he should become a teacher. Plagued throughout his life by poor eyesight and migraine headaches, kind of sort of retired in 79, suffered a mental breakdown, etc. And we have some influences on him. Greek culture, particularly the philosophies of Plato and Aristotle. Arthur Schopenhauer had a great impact on him. We talked about Schopenhauer and Wagner, right, already, or not? I didn't do that. Here yet, right? So who is Schopenhauer? Schopenhauer was actually a student of Hegel. Hegel was one of his committee that approved his PhD thesis, and yet his PhD thesis was an argument against Hegel's philosophy. So that's kind of funny, actually. He also was absolutely convinced that once he started teaching, he would put Hegel out of business. So he arranged his class schedules to be exactly the same times as Hegel's classes. And he predicted within 2 years, Hegel's classes will be empty. But actually, within 2 years, his classes were empty. And he was so pissed off, he just quit and basically went to his house on Frankfurt am Main, which was a really nice house. It was a nice upscale neighborhood. Still there, you can see pictures of it. It's right along the river. And sulked the rest of his life. Wrote books and stuff, but basically sat there, probably did some drugs. I don't know. He's not one of my favorites, because he's so depressing. He's considered one of the first to reflect the influence, influence coming into Europe of Buddhism. So he kind of accepts Buddhism and adopts that into his philosophy. The first official influence of that in European thought. He's also aware of the theory of evolution. He also has a friendship with Richard Wagner. I'm mixing Nietzsche and Schopenhauer. Actually, Schopenhauer has a relationship with Wagner too. In fact, Schopenhauer inspired Wagner. One of the things that Schopenhauer argued is that when you look at kind of the problem that we have, the phenomena is what we experience, and so there's an ego out here and an id. Somehow we've got to figure out why that is there. The numinous is out here. Schopenhauer's response to all this is that what drives everything is the will. And what on earth did he mean by the will? It's not a good thing. How does that reflect, say, in art? So if we go and look at, how about this? Triumph of the will. Is that Schopenhauer's conception of the will? Probably. Does it mean that Hitler understood that? I don't know. Probably not. At least not the same way I would. This is the famous Riefenstahl is the, she was the one that directed this. And it's held up often as like an art film. This is a classic example of how to use propaganda. There's this new technology called movies. It's propaganda. And by the way, notice he also uses airplanes as part of this. That's the First World War. Imagine most of the people in the movie theater have never been on an airplane.
That'd be pretty cool.
This is like, whoa. Move it up a little bit. You can notice this is on the web. It's there for free. In fact, it's considered a cult film by some groups that, of course, we would not want to be politically affiliated with, etc.
Still banned on being played in Germany? Or do you know?
This just came out in a new publication in Germany. That's not the new one. I don't know about this movie or why it would be banned.
Says on the Wikipedia page for it that it's banned.
Really?
I don't know if that's current information or...
Okay, so his plane lands. Notice how many cameras do they have involved in this, right? Yeah, so here he comes. So now he's on the car driving through town. So you've got a camera behind him, which, for some reason, when we look at the whole car, do you see the camera? And they had to be big cameras back then. You see a camera there?
They filmed it twice?
Well, I'm sure they didn't, because they only drove through the town once, I'm sure.
It was a different car that was filming? No?
I don't know how they did, obviously.
Did you just use stock footage of him doing that?
No, I don't think so.
The Germans were pretty innovative, though, so he might have had a small camera. It's hard to see.
Either way, Schopenhauer said that the will, the concept of this will is like almost like the Buddhist karma, or you might call it a fate motif behind everything. You know, you do what you do and everything, but stuff happens, right? And it's like there's just a direction to how all that stuff happens, right? Can you control it? No. Can you figure out the way it's moving? Perhaps. And so basically, you know, like the surfboarder, right? Here comes the wave. You can't, you know, take the surfboard and tell the wave, okay, move this way. No, the wave goes the way it wants to go. But if you're a good surfboarder, you know how the wave is going, and you can kind of, what's it called? Get into that cone. You know, there's a name for
it. The tube?
The tube? Tubular, right? That's where they even get that, right? When you get into the tube. death watching this today. Sieg Heil, by the way, means hail victory. Sieg, S-I-E-G, is victory, and Heil is hail. And their salute, by the way, was adopted from Mussolini's salute, which was like this, which was supposed to be based on the Roman salute, which was actually what they used. Did I get that right? One was like this, one was like this, right? I'm pretty sure the German is like this.
Das Jahrtausende beherrschte und in Jahrzehnten entstanden wäre. Der größte Bau hat auch das längste Backzeichen Arbeitsbestrich.
Well, you get the idea. Yes? So, the will, the triumph of the will, title of the movie, is clearly, I think, a Schopenhauer and Nietzsche, and Nietzsche's going to use it as well. But Nietzsche, continuing on with Nietzsche, is also influenced by the theory of evolution, and all of them, Wagner, Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, have a relation. Now, the thing is with Schopenhauer, Schopenhauer has had that influence on Wagner. So if we look at the art associated with Wagner's music, how many of you have heard things by Wagner before? Like, you've probably all heard this. Yes, everyone's heard this.
Mm-hmm.
If you've remember the movie Apocalypse Now, which is why that comes up, that's the music that the colonel played for the helicopter gunships as they being streaming in to strafe the village. Makes the crew on the helicopter feel good, and it scares the crap out of the villagers, I guess.
Love the smell of napalm in the morning.
Yep. Okay, so this is just the musical piece. If you listen to the actual opera, you get oh, here we go. This looks like the Met or someone. So, the actual opera, you would have the Valkyries themselves on stage, one way or another, represented by like flying horses or whatever. And they sing, of course. So this is where you get the women with the helmets and the spears. And Valkyries were kind of like the death angels of the German tradition, that they would come, you know, the like Wotan, that tradition, right? And they would come to the battlefields and gather all the fallen heroes and take them to Valhalla. So that's what their function was. But they're all daughters of Wotan. Wotan, who's the high god, like Zeus, right, had relations with Earth, Erda, and the Valkyries were like their children. They also had Sigmund and Sieglinde, right? So that was a Schwellingspaar, which is really fun, right? And we say twins, right? Schwellingspaar, right? Isn't that cool? I love that some of the German is just kind of neat. You know, like the joints, even, you know, like our knee is German. It's actually the middle knee, and the ankle is your lower knee. Which explains why this is your high knee. That was a joke. Sorry. Pardon? Sorry. I just say that though, I'm not really sorry. However. So Wagner, I should show you his ugly face. Wagner. Some interesting things about him. Supposed to have a really big head. He is relatively short, so that's kind of interesting. He couldn't write music unless he was making love to some woman or another.
Excuses.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's not like he was writing music while... No, I mean, you know, he needed to be in love to be inspired, you know, so...
Okay.
Etc. So that's kind of interesting. But apart from his early operas, which were at least moderately successful, although they're not played very often, if at all, anymore, Rienzi, I guess, was the most successful of them. Das Liebesgebot, or the wedding ban, something, it's actually love's ban. You're not allowed to fall in love. It's a crazy plot. But that's not very popular at all. But his first major hit was Tannhäuser, which if you listen to it today, it's like really boring. Some basic, I could do Tannhäuser. Maybe spell it close, I guess close. You know, always just be close, you don't have to. You may have heard of this. You may have heard this music. It's played often. in concert version. It, you don't have to hear it in an opera performance. It's about a monk on the Crusades that goes to Jerusalem, finds a woman selling herself for sex, etc. This is way before Paris bans paying for sex. That just happened yesterday, actually. If you followed the news, it's kind of interesting. And a lot of prostitutes were out in various squares with, "Keep your hands off our customers," or something.
Paris?
Yeah, Paris. That's my reading of the signs.
Prostitution's still legal in Amsterdam.
Well, what does that mean, prostitutes divided? Prostitute in Jerusalem, and he converts her to Christianity and saves her so she can go to heaven, and that's the end. So that's the whole opera. Only 5 hours, I suppose, for that to happen. So,
pretty boring.
I would think so. Yeah. The next one that's even more, much more successful, actually, was, oh, I forgot Flying Dutchman. Flying Dutchman was pretty popular too. That was actually before Tannhäuser. Flying Dutchman, you're probably all familiar with the pirate or sea captain that can't go to heaven until some woman falls in love with him. And so they have to keep sailing around with all of his skeleton crew because they can't go to heaven. They're dead, but they can't go to heaven until some woman falls in love with him. He lands at a port, and a woman knows the story and decides she's going to fall in love with him, so she sacrifices herself for him. And so the ship all, at the end, you know, yay, we're all dead now. You know, it's very dark, dreary. Well, this is the whole thing, 2 hours. Well, this is one of the famous choruses. She sings about it for a while first. So she just doesn't jump off the cliff. She has to sing about the passion that the will makes her go do this? So she jumps somehow, metaphorically, I suppose. Because, you know, when you're on a stage, it's kind of hard to actually, I saw a beautiful soprano kill herself on Saturday. Madame Butterfly. You ever seen Madame Butterfly? Oh, Puccini. Oh my goodness. Oh, it was so great. You guys don't know what you're missing. Oh my goodness. We had 4 tickets, so one of my friends brought a friend who was from a village and had never even seen like a play or anything. And here we're watching the Met live, HD, in the Century 16, big, you know, screen. Oh my goodness, what a beautiful performance. So in any case, so Lohengrin. You know this. Oh, okay, so let's just go right to this. I'm sure you all know this. Some of you may have even been doing something stupid while listening to this music. Getting married is a brilliant thing to do. I highly recommend it for all my male students. Find the smartest young woman that will marry you, marry them, and then do what they say. And give them all your money also, right? You know, the whole thing. You know, let them be in charge of your life. You will live longer, you'll be richer, happier, you know, all those wonderful things. The odd thing, the flip side of that, is that the poor woman will be worse off than if she had stayed single. Statistically, it seems that single women are much happier than married ones because they don't have this guy that they have to, you know, keep in line. That's very so low and good. Okay. So how does the will play out? Well, in the longest series of operas probably ever written, how many folks know what the longest symphony ever is? There is an official longest or largest symphony. By Brian... Havergal Brian? Is Brian the first name or the second?
No idea.
I didn't say it was a good one. I just said it's like the largest. I think the most orchestra, etc. So when we look at the ring cycle, thus Rheingold is the first. Not nearly as interesting if you don't get to see all the Rhine maidens splashing around in their bikinis. In the Rheingold, you have a dwarf, or a Nibelungen, who lives underground. So Nibelheim, underground. Home, underground. Nibel is below. Heim is home. So you have Alberich, who lives underground. He sees these beautiful Rhine maidens swimming in the Rhine, so they're basically like mermaids. And some of the performances, they really have. They're supposed to be spending it. Depends on how they stage it, etc. But so they're guarding the gold. The Rhine means pure, and gold, so Rhine gold, right? So this is the gold of the river that basically is the life of the river. Right? Alberich falls in love with these beautiful bikini clad maidens and wants to make love with them. And they laugh at him because he is so short and ugly. By the way, here's an absolutely clear implication of all this. The dwarves, or the Nibelungens, are Jews. So this is anti-Semitic. Right. And by the way, Hitler loves the Ring Cycle, all the operas, and he says that one of the proudest things he had was that he had listened to the fourth one 100 times. Hitler, 100 times, watched Wagner's. So that's Alberich. He's supposed to look ugly. You know, and their wives look like that too. It's probably the beards. That's a pun from The Lord of the Rings, right? Everybody knows? No? Yes. Lord of the Rings?
Yes.
Peter Jackson's movies?
Yeah. Tolkien's books first?
Same, well, it's not the same plot, but it's the power, ring of power, right? So Alberich steals the gold, makes a ring of power from it, and then basically makes his... all of his tribe, or whatever you want to call them, mine gold for him, so he has this hoard of gold. He also has a helmet, which is magical. You put it on, and you can become whatever you want. So you can put it on and be a dragon, or you can look like a frog, or whatever. Meanwhile, Wotan and his other gods are celebrating the completion of Valhall, that's now being finished. This is a great big castle in the sky somewhere, and he's hired these giants to build this castle. And when they complete the castle, he's supposed to pay them, and what he's agreed to pay them is Freyja, who's one of the goddesses. Can't pay with Freyja, you know that's wrong. Plus, she's the one who's in charge of the golden apples, which keeps the gods young, right? Yes. So there's two main reasons you can't pay for Valhall with Freyja, because she's one of us, you can't give one of us to the giants. Plus, we need the apples, right? And we need her, right? But the giants come, they've completed the Valhall, and they insist on their payment, and Wotan's job as king, god, is contracts. And they're all on his spear, right? So he has to follow his contract. So he promised Freyja, so they get Freyja. And they walk off with Freyja. What are we going to do? Well, we've got to find some way of getting Freyja back. Loge, who's fire, right? And also logic, by the way, comes up with a great idea. Hey, I hear Alberich has this hoard of gold. We could go down there, outsmart him, and take the gold, steal the gold, right? And then use it to buy Freyja back. Okay, let's go try it. So they go down to... I don't know what scene this is. This looks like it's just the first part of it. So they go down, they find Albrecht, they do trick him, trick him into becoming a frog, and he puts the magic helmet over his, and he becomes a frog. They step on him, take the ring, take the helmet, and they make, you know, all the gold get transported up. They use it to buy Freya back, but the ring is cursed. So everybody that puts the ring on is now going to be in trouble, and in fact, Votan has already done that. So the whole rest of the series is Votan forced by fate, the will, right, this undercurrent of will that will make itself happen, right? There's nothing you can do about it. Even Votan, the head of the gods, cannot stop this fate, right? He's put the ring on, he's going to be cursed, right? And so what eventually happens is the ring goes to the giants end up fighting over it, they kill one kills the other one takes the gold, hides in a cave, puts the helmet on, becomes dragon to guard the gold. But right away, Votan is possessed by this power of the ring, and he wants it back, and so he decides to have a child to go get it, because he cannot go get it himself, because that's breaking his contract. But he can have a child, he figures, who will go and get it for him. So he has Sigmund. By the way, we end up with a Swelling's Par, so we get both... this is the Valkyrie, Sigmund, Hagen? No, it's not Hagen. Hagen is the... Am I boring you, or is this interesting? A little sexy. That's his sister. That's Sieglinde, his sister. They don't know that they're twins, by the way, because they've been separated since they were little. And he takes the sword out of the tree. So anyway, he finds his sister, he gets the sword that his father's left him to go and kill the dragon, right? The trouble is, it's Hera in Greek, but Fricka in German, right? So Fricka is Votan's wife. Her job is marriage, protecting marriage. She's mad that Sigmund stole Sieglinde from whoever the guy is, I forget his name. And so he's broken the marriage contract, so she insists that Sigmund cannot live. So Votan's pissed off, but he has to listen to his wife, right? You know. And so, of course, he arranges for Sigmund to be stabbed by the Hunding. That's his name. Hunding is the husband of Sieglinde. But just in this brief amount of time that they've been together, Sieglinde is pregnant with Sigmund's child.
It's her brother?
Yes. Mm. And she ends up giving birth to Siegfried, right? Which is free victory, right? And then she dies. So this baby is found by a dwarf, relative of Albrecht, and raises it knowing full well, as he's got the pieces of the sword, the sword's been broken, right? So he's got the sword, he's got the baby, and he knows this baby's destined to kill the dragon and get the gold, so he figures, aha, I'll raise the child, then when he's old enough and he kills the dragon, I'll get the gold, right? You know, but he needs to also fix the sword, and he can't, so he ends up having to finally have Siegfried himself fix the sword. So that happens. So this is Siegfried repairing the sword. And I think, by the way, this is my favorite music from the whole... He doesn't know it, but it was his grandfather that did it. Wotan broke. Remember, Mima, who is the dwarf, is planning on killing him as soon as he kills the dragon. And notice he's ugly, because remember, this is anti-Semitic, and all these dwarves are supposed to be, you know, always after the gold, ugly, no one loves them, you know, all these things, you know. So it's the caricature of everything bad about the Jewish race. And they thought it was a race, right? You know that. See, Wagner referred to these as music dramas. We certainly call them operas now. Although opera literally means work. Operate? Opera. Opus? That's Latin, right? So he fixes the sword. And then he goes off with Mima showing him where the dragon is. You know, it's more complex than that, of course. I mean, it's 5 hours. You know, you have to have other stuff happen. Right? But he, in fact, ends up fighting the dragon.
And I think maybe it
Jay, he's great. He's from Texas. When you listen to him actually talk, he's got a Texan accent. So it's absolutely hilarious. You know, you hear him singing German tenor. Oh, you know, and then he talks to you and it's like, I'm in San Antonio. What happened here? It's really funny. Kills the dragon. Here we go. Oh, so this isn't the Met. Of course, he just doesn't quickly kill the dragon. He has to sing a duet with the dragon first.
Right. It is an opera, after all.
Where is the dragon? So he kills the dragon, gets the gold, including the ring, and then he walks off because a little bird tells him, if you go this way, and then over, and then up and around, and you'll find this ring of fire, and inside the ring of fire, you'll find Brunhild, who's one of the Valkyries, who's been put to sleep, surrounded by fire, to protect her, so only the greatest hero can actually get her, right? But that's because she tried to protect his father when Wotan, her father, was trying to kill him, etc. So in any case, so he goes off in search of Brunhild. And on the way, he meets Wotan, who says, okay, now you're my grandson. Give me the gold. Give me the ring. You know, after all, you know, I'm the one that, you know, did all this so that that happens. And Siegfried, who's free victory, has no bondage to grandfather. And in fact, he ends up slicing through Wotan's spear.
Yeah, I used to have
which destroys Wotan's power. Which is why we're now living in an age of men instead of gods, but they're all... I'm gonna see him kill the dragon. This is fun. You know, it never looks very realistic, no matter how they do. So he finds Brunhild. So he's just woken her up, and she's seeing the sun for the first time in, well, his whole lifetime. So, as you can imagine. So within 30 minutes, she has to be woken up from such a deep sleep, just realize that she's no longer a power maiden, because she's lost her power, and fall in love with this young brute, who has just rescued her, because she's destined to be his wife, right? So within half an hour, the soprano has to go through all these, so I'm not inventing that myself. I actually heard a soprano interviewed who explained, in half an hour, you've got to be, you know, this. So imagine.
Busy half hour, huh?
So anyway, she becomes his wife, she gives him all her power, she protects him all in the front, she forgets the back. You know how that works, right? The hero, he'll never run away from the enemy, so he doesn't need protection in the back, right? You know how that works, right? And where's he going to get it? In the back, right? You know, that's how that happens, right? So of course he ends up meeting one of Alberich's son, who is planning to kill him so he can get the gold for Alberich from him, and in fact he does kill him, but he ends up not getting the ring. Instead, the Rhine washes over his funeral pyre, and that's the end of everything. And meanwhile, the fire has set fire to Valhall, so that's the end of the gods. So it's the last opera is the twilight of the gods. So Die Götterdämmerung. So, there's two other operas that are highly of note with regard to this force of the will. One is Tristan and Isolde, which is a 5-hour opera about a man falling in love with a woman and the woman falling in love with him. He travels to Ireland to pick her up, to bring her back to the king, who's supposed to marry her. But on the ship, they fall in love with one another, and they realize that it is just hopelessly in love with one another. And so they commit mutual suicide on the way home. 5 hours to do that, right? So that's Tristan and Isolde. And it's again, this power of this will of that emotion that overpowers them. And the last one is Parsifal, which is the most boring of all of them, I think. It's absolutely gorgeous. So even though it's boring, it's just, if you can stand this kind of music for 5 hours, it's absolutely incredible, right? And by the way, people go and listen to these operas, like the Ring Cycle. They're performed the world over. Seattle has a Ring Cycle. The main performance venue, though, is Bayreuth, which Wagner built for them. So that's... I guess you can see it.
According to linguists, the name Bayreuth refers back to the forest that was cut down by the Bavarians to make room for the settlement. Whether this is true or not is unknown. The city itself was annexed to Bavaria only in 1810 and was turned into a memorial museum in the 1970s. Specialists consider the most valuable part of the legacy to be the score of 8 operas with their drafts, instructions for the orchestra, and letters. The composer died in 1883 while on a trip to Venice, and was buried in the garden of the villa.
Tod von Venedig.
The Neue Schloss of Newcastle is also situated in the Hofgarten near Wanfried. Today, the Baroque Palace houses the local history collection, including, of course, Wagner's statue, and in the other wing, the rich collection of the National Gallery can be seen. Bayreuth is located on the Main River between the Fichtel Mountains and the Frankish Alp, and was annexed to Bavaria by Napoleon.
So, in any case, how much time do I have? I've got to be careful, 10 minutes? So, Nietzsche and Wagner were... Nietzsche was a fan of Wagner. Wagner was a fan of Schopenhauer. Nietzsche broke up the relationship with Wagner when it became so obvious to him that he was such an anti-Semite. Because Nietzsche was actually against anti-Semitism. And plus, he thought of himself not as German, but as a European. Right? In fact, he advertised himself as the first European. Right? So, what's Nietzsche's take on all of this, right? Well, he's aware of Hegel's philosophy, so just like Kierkegaard, he's aware of the individual that has this education, which you're getting, of course, by taking this course, right? You're aware that all of the meta-narratives out there, the traditional meta-narratives, like the Christian worldview, man-made, not true. And in general, stories cannot be true or false. Stories are good or bad. And you take the moral of the story. You know, what's the moral of the story? What's that story teach? You know, Aesop's fairy tales, right, and so on. But so basically, a story is not true or false. There are observation sentences that are true or false. That's a mouse, right? You know, that's the sunglasses, right? Those are true, no problem. Lincoln is in the corner back there. That's false. You know, to everyone except me, because I'm the only one that can see him, right? You know, observation sentences are true or false, but stories are neither true nor false, and we can have interpretations of them, etc., but strictly speaking, none of the meta-narratives that explain why life is meaningful, why we should be here, why life exists, except for the answer 42, of course. 42 is the answer. What's the question? But you get the idea, right? You know, that none of these are true. They're all man-made. So you're just a sheep if you believe it. And you're being manipulated by the bureaucracy that wants you to believe that narrative. So you're basically under their power, right? If you become an Übermensch now, you've evolved to the next level, and it's not a biological step in evolution. It's a mental step. Right? where you now realize that you're responsible for creating your own meaning in your life, right? I don't believe any of those folks out there. You have to become a critical thinker. You have to be the one to think for yourself. Wow, that sounds so American, actually, if you think about it. All right? You have to be your own boss. You have to create meaning for yourself. Right? And anyone that still thinks, you know, that the church is true and I'm a member of that, you know, they don't realize that God is dead. One of Nietzsche's lines, right? You know, and he's actually taking it from Martin Luther, points out that God is dead, we have killed him, right? He died for our sins, right? But Nietzsche says God is dead. The reason God is dead is because we no longer need that story. It was just a story, and we've graduated. We no longer need that story to give our lives meaning, because it's a false. It's a corrupt God. You know, this is the crypt of the dead God. Right? God is dead. Now, by the way, remember the bathroom quote, you know, you see, you know, while you're sitting there, there's the thing, God is dead, Nietzsche, right, on the bathroom stall. And then underneath it, you see, Nietzsche is dead, God, right? Sorry, you know, it's just one of those, you know, stupid things. But Nietzsche said, you know, so God is dead. Now, as an Ubermensch, you have to create God. Your meaning has to come from you. So what's Nietzsche's solution to that? Remember, Marx says this is, you know, fate, you know, is going to be freedom, but how? By communism, etc. Kierkegaard, you have to take a leap of faith and believe something, and it didn't really work for him. For Nietzsche, what you have to do is create meaning. You have to create meaning from moment to moment. So for example, if you're an artist, I love this one. You've been to the art building? No? Yes? This is art. Right, you've seen it. It's on the corner of the lawn,
yeah.
Right, as you come around to our art building. Oppenheim, Dennis Oppenheim, built that with assistance from lots of people. In fact, I think it cost $500,000. He didn't get the money. That was the cost of building it. Right? It's art. Name of it is Image Intervention. Frankly, when you see it, don't you feel like, why is there a pile of junk on the lawn?
Yes.
What does it mean? You feel like, you know, this is just ridiculous. It's not art. Well, a good artist is going to persuade you to think that this is art and interesting and telling an important...
it's like a waste of space to me.
Shoot. I spelled your shop right. I mean, for example, here's Duchamp's urinal, right? This is art. I see that, and I think it's a old urinal that's just been, like, thrown out, and he picked it up, and he brought it into the museum.
I think this is the decline of Western civilization is what we're looking at.
You know, I mean,
you try to throw things like that at us as being art. That's where's the creativity in that?
He had to sign them all. Is that a signature?
Yeah, right?
I think that's,
but that's written
that's
in English, and he
one.
Followed rules to do that. So.
So here's another piece of art. This is a crucifix in a bottle of the artist's urine, and then he took a photo of it, right? And it's art, right? Ooh, You see where I'm going with this? These artists are persuading us to believe that the crap they're foisting on us and charging us incredible amounts of money for is great art, right? Well, it isn't. Really, it isn't, right? But they have so much meaningfulness in their life by persuading us sheep to buy this crap. Think how it makes them feel,
Or right. Urine in this case.
Or urine. Well, I mean, the urine, it's just a picture, so it's not like you actually would be buying the actual urine.
No.
But I mean, you can buy cans of shit. How do I get out of this now? Shoot.
Well, you started it.
You know that shit actually stands for Ship High in Transit?
Exactly. For the boats.
Yep. That's where the term came from.
Well, this is actually real artist shit. You could buy, you know, and it's very expensive. I don't know if you can get it on Amazon. I don't know if they're allowed to ship that shit to...
As long as they stack it high in transit.
I mean, so what's going on here? Basically, artists are trying to create something shocking, perhaps, unusual, but at the same time, they have some sort of accompanying narrative that explains why this is something you ought to buy, right? And what makes them feel powerful and have meaning in their lives is succeeding in convincing you to buy this crap. Shit.
Right.
It's not my fault, right? I'm just trying to describe, this is Nietzsche's theory, right? You know, to give meaning to your life, basically you have to be creating meaning and persuading others to accept it, right?
So prey on the gullibility of others.
Yes. Yes. Oh, Hitler, of course, is thinking in the same terms, the Übermensch. He wants to be that Führer that leads the folk, right? You know, so there you go, right? Madonna, as a Nietzschean something. I can't see it. That's interesting. And when he invented hell for himself, that was his very heaven for Nietzsche. Come here, fuck down? What's that? I can't see what that's. Maybe that's the hat is made out of fuck down instead of duck down? I don't know. I don't know what that. See, Sirik, in video to Living for Love, see superstar Madonna, je monte, rasi, all well. That's.
I don't know what the hat's in German says.
The hat's in German?
Maybe.
I think it might be. Is it like the.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking. But you could probably Google what it says on the hat. People will do that.
So my question for today is, are there any Nietzscheans that you find likable people? Is that a good question?
Sure.
Hitler? No, we wouldn't like Hitler. Madonna? Madonna?
No.
Definitely talented. I don't like her music, but I mean, I certainly couldn't create it.
Some boys hug me, some boys kiss me, I think they're okay, yay. If they give me proper credit, I don't turn away, yay. Because we are living in a material world, and I am a material girl. Good?
She's been making music for a long time.
She's my age! And she's still out there singing like this.
Right.
And she's not like, that old.
She's fallen off a horse and broken her hip. And she's bought babies. Has she had her own baby? Or did she just buy them all? I can't remember.
No, she's had kids.
She has?
Yeah. Mortis, Rock.
We got a fan in our midst.
Oh, no. She's been in the news over with her 15-year-old son
and her ex.
She has gone through all sorts of change, right? So
numerous.
She's the material girl. But the trouble is you can't just stick with that created self. Because then you become dominated by everyone expecting you to behave that way.
Yeah.
What you have to do is keep creating.
Evolving.
Which means you have to keep surprising people. You know, do something different.
Being shocking.
Have a good weekend.
You too.
What's this
See you later.
Was this a fun class?
It was interesting. Were you asking him?
It was slow.
Oh, you too? It was slow?
Yeah. It was slow. I mean, I got here late, but all that stuff's depressing.
And that slows it up? Or
yeah.
is it
it's
that
slow,
the
well,
opera
it's not,
is slow?
The opera is depressing. Those long, drawn-out operas. I'm not a big fan of opera. I'll go and see one if it's a good one, but those ones are not.
Oh,
those
right.
Those
are not right.
interest. But no, I understand we have to go through all of that stuff. Is your camera still recording?
Oh, thanks. I may have. Hopefully, I did do that because I intended to. Yes.